We'll start.
Yeah, Dr. Gopathy, we can start now.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. On behalf of International Road Federation India Chapter, I extend a warm welcome to you all in this 7th webinar. You may perhaps recall that IRFIC started this webinar series during the Road Safety Month this year, which is observed each year in the month of January. The purpose of this webinar series is twofold. First, to disseminate the state of the art knowledge on a broad subject like road safety, and the second is to formulate a plan of recommendations as a way forward for the implementation in the country for some selected states. We have planned 12 webinars to be conducted for the whole year, and today is the 7th in this series. Now, today's webinar is on intelligent transport system for road safety. This is a very important topic, and we have the pleasure to announce that the session will be moderated by Mr. Balraj Bhanot, former director ARAI and chairman CMVR-TSC. We have five eminent speakers for today's webinar. They are Mr. Sudhendu Jyoti Sinha, our guest speaker today. He is the advisor Niti Aayog. The other speakers are Mr. Alok Sethi, general manager DIMTIS New Delhi, Dr. Madhusudan Joshi, head electronics division ICAT Manesar, Mr. Chaitanya Bhatt will not be able to present his talk. However, Mr. Basak will replace him and present Mr. Bhatt's talk. Professor P.K. Sarkar, former professor at School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. And last but not the least, Mr. Prakash Rudrayan, Joint Director, CDAC, Thiruvananthapuram. They will all formally be introduced by the moderator, and I will just like to inform you that finally, it is my pleasure to wish and keep on record our deep sense of appreciation to the moderator and all the speakers for taking out their valuable time and agreeing to enrich us with their knowledge and wisdom. Please note that the recommendations emerging out of today's webinar will be shared with moderator and all the speakers for preparing the action plan. Now, may I request Mr. Somnath Ghosh, because unfortunately Mr. Kapila, our president emeritus, is not feeling well. So may I request Mr. Somnath Ghosh for the address to the audience.
Thank you. I'm speaking on behalf of Mr. K.K. Kapila, President Emeritus, International Road Federation. As Dr. Gangopadhyay has said, he's not keeping well. He has said, I'm reading out, please. At the outset, I extend my warm welcome to dear Dr. Sinha, an alumnus of St. Stephen's College and a highly decorated Indian Railways officer. He's a recipient of the National Award for E-Governance in 2019-2020. An advisor in Niti Aayog, and our guest speaker of the day. I also extend a warm welcome to Mr. Balraj Bhanot, my dear friend, the mentor of the automobile industry policy and practice in India, who can rightly be called the Bhishma Pitama of the Indian automobile industry, who is a moderator of the webinar today. I would also like to warmly welcome other distinguished speakers, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. 1.3 million people are killed and about 50 million are injured in the world every year. This costs the world US dollars 1.8 trillion. In India, about 150,000 fatalities and 500,000 injuries, including permanent disabilities, are reported every year. The economic loss is pegged at 3% of the GDP. The UN's Decade of Action 2010-2020 envisaged to bring down road accidents and fatalities by 50% by the end of the decade. In India, considerable efforts such as removal of black spots, road safety education, emergency care trainings, etc., were made by multiple stakeholders, including the government, NGOs, and industry. All these efforts of the decade could only create awareness about the serious concern of road safety in the minds of the stakeholders. In terms of any noticeable reduction in the number of road accidents or fatalities, the efforts failed to produce any significant improvements. The main reason for this was that the efforts were not undertaken in a structured manner. Road safety is a function of 5 E's: engineering of roads, engineering of vehicles and policy corrections, education, enforcement, and emergency care. It is necessary to work on all of them simultaneously. The IRFIC has embarked upon its road safety plan for India for this decade with the focus on 5 E's. Accordingly, a 12 webinar series titled Road Safety Challenges in India and Preparations of an Action Plan was launched on 9th February 2021 by Shri Nitin Gadkari ji, Honorable Minister of Road Transport and Highways and MSME. Each webinar will cover 3 to 4 subtopics under the webinar theme. From the current webinar, we would like to leverage and incorporate in Road Safety Action Plan as to how the ITS can be leveraged for road safety. I would like to thank each member of today's webinar team for assisting us in this yagna. Recommendations arising out of each webinar will be collated to finalize the National Plan on Road Safety, which will be implemented with the support of all stakeholders. Besides the webinar, IRF is now ready to undertake ground level activities in 7 states of Karnataka, Kerala, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, and Uttar Pradesh, based on the number of road accidents and fatalities. Various interventions based on 5 E's will be undertaken to showcase the efficacy of the above initiatives. The Honorable Minister has written to the Chief Ministers of these states to extend support to IRF. Our interventions have begun in various states from this month and will conclude, including the works envisaged to be undertaken for mitigation measures by 30th November 2021. I earnestly hope and pray that Corona pandemic does not delay this validation program. Road safety audit on the worst affected road section of 100 to 150 km for addressal of mitigation measures to make these as forgiving as possible. Road safety education in schools and other educational institutions, as well as sensitizing the local population. A road safety anthem has been prepared on all languages of India, and the exercise to prepare in all other major spoken languages of the world is in progress. I'm pleased to play it in Hindi for your listening pleasure.
सड़कों पे सावधानी पहली प्राथमिकता है, नियम का पालन करना है भैया, नहीं करनी है मनमानी, गुस्सा नहीं करना, मुस्कान फैलानी है, दाएं देखो बाएं देखो फिर दाएं देख के पार करो, पैदल सड़क पे जो हो हेडफोन ना यूज करो, थोड़ी सी लापरवाही जीवन भर का है रोना, चौंकना रह कर ही चमकाओगे हर कोना, सड़कों पे सावधानी पहली प्राथमिकता है।
We will work on all the other E's in the same manner. Our efforts are to work relentlessly to achieve the targets set by the Honorable Minister Shri Nitin Gadkari ji, and I have personally taken a pledge to achieve 50% reduction in road accident and fatalities by 2025. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my commitment to you. But to make it happen, I humbly solicit with folded hands wholehearted support in this yagya by sensitizing your friends and family about adherence of road safety rules and sensitizing them how important it is to make a sincere effort to reduce accidents and fatalities, as well as by contributing generously to IRF India. You may visit IRF website at www.indiairf.com for more details as given on the screen here. Let us pledge to leave no stone unturned in this effort and we collectively achieve our target. God bless, thank you, and Jai Hind.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ghosh, for reading out on behalf of Mr. Kapila. Now, we'd like to bring it to you the messages that we have received from John Todd, the President FIA, and
Dr. Gangopadhyay, you are muted.
I'm sorry. Thank you, Mr. Ghosh, for reading out the speech of Mr. Kapila. It is my pleasure now to announce that we'll like to bring it to you the messages by John Todd, President FIA and Special Envoy to UN Secretary General on Road Safety, and Mr. Bill Halkias, President IRF Geneva.
Honorable Minister Nitin Gadkari, my dear Kiran Kapila, ladies and gentlemen, achieving safe mobility and transport systems is one of the most pressing social, economic, health, and development challenges of our time. In countries where motorization is rapidly growing, like in India, some of the busiest roads are 20 times more dangerous than similar European ones. This is an enormous gap that we need to close urgently. There is added momentum for us to address this scourge. We embark on a new United Nations Decade of Action for Road Safety, and we must all recommit to deliver on 2030 targets. This aim to halve the number of road deaths and injuries, the SDG 3.6, and to provide access to safe, affordable, accessible, and sustainable transport system for all by 2030, SDG 11.2. And with the progress made in the last decade and the tools we have gathered, we are equipped to make the difference. We have the UN Road Safety Conventions, a UN Road Safety Fund, global voluntary performance targets, and a global plan of action underway. I thank the International Road Federation for playing its significant part in this global effort. I commend your work in supporting stakeholders to improve roads, which ultimately benefit local communities, including children, who are, as we all know, among the most vulnerable. I wish you a productive webinar and look forward to a fruitful journey rewarded by lives saved on the road. And you know, you can count on me. Thank you.
Can you play Mr. Bill Halkias?
Honorable Minister of Road Transport and Highways and MSMEs, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, esteemed dignitaries, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the International Road Federation, a very warm welcome to all. I thank each and every one of you for joining. Honorable Minister of Road Transport and Honorable Minister of Road Transport and Highways and MSMEs, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, esteemed dignitaries, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the International Road Federation, a very warm welcome to all. I thank each and every one of you for joining us today in these very difficult and complicated times. The COVID-19 pandemic is having extensive ramifications to the entire planet. But apart from the COVID-19 pandemic, there is another pandemic that has been claiming lives and affecting healthcare, business and jobs for years, the road traffic accident pandemic. According to the World Health Organization, road traffic accidents were responsible for an estimated 1,350,000 deaths worldwide in 2016, out of which 150,000 or 11% in India alone. Neither doth tell is acceptable. What is worse is that road traffic crashes are completely preventable, and there is a lot that can be done to ensure that they are reduced globally. No government, no citizen, none of us should have to compromise on the safety of his family. Our collective task should be to create a truly safe, sustainable, and efficient multimodal transportation system. To finally defeat the road traffic accident pandemic, we need to work in true partnership, public and private, industry and civil society, and we need to create the conditions to do so. Last but not least, we should not forget about our human capital. We must invest in capacity building. We can adequately respond to challenges only if we have skilled personnel. On behalf of the International Road Federation, I would like to invite each and every one of you to engage with the IRF to shape a better road and transport sector and a better future for all. I would like to praise and thank India, its government and its institutions for their bold initiatives in promoting road traffic safety. And I will say to the Honorable Minister, to the President of the India Chapter of IRF, Dr. Gangopatiya, and to my good friend President Emeritus of IRF Geneva, Mr. Kiran Kapila, keep up the good work. And to all of you in India and elsewhere, please follow their example. We are all united for road safety, because united we rise and united we deliver. Thank you all.
Okay, thank you very much. So we move ahead. Now we move to the technical session. And it is my immense pleasure that today's session will be moderated by none other than Mr. Balraj Bhanot. I'll just briefly read out his CV or the biodata. He will be moderating the session. Mr. Bhanot is having double engineering degree and postgraduate diploma in industrial management and an MBA from FMS Delhi. Mr. Bhanot is the former director of Automobile Research Association of India, ARAI. He was also the DDG of the Department of Heavy Industries and headed the technical wing to participate in UNECA WP29, which actually prescribes the global regulations for automobile. He was the chairman of Transport Engineering and Divisional Council TEDC of BIS, and he was also the founder chairman of CMVR Technical Standing Committee. Mr. Bhanot was also the chairman of the committee of finalizing the bus and truck body code for the country, and he was India's first electronics advisor in EEC in business during 1978 to 1983. He served in numerous committees for developing standards related to automobiles in the country. Mr. Bhanot is the chairman of TED 31, dealing with the INC regime for motor vehicles in the country. Mr. Bhanot has been conferred the prestigious Prince Michael International Road Safety Award, SAE International Award for Safety Regulations on CNG Buses, Golden Peacock Award for Quality Management, and also the Lifetime Achievement Award in 2015. by SAE India Foundation. So you can see the, you know, such eminent personality, and it is our pleasure that he will be moderating this today's technical session. So without taking much of the time, I now request Mr. Bhanot to take it over and then conduct the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Gangopadhyay, for the kind words. And I like to share my screen. Just let me see. Are you able to see that or no? Hello?
Hello? Are able to see, yes, it. Sir, yes, sir. It's a calendar. It shows the calendar.
Oh.
Mr. Bhanot, please unshare and share again the actual presentation. First, please unshare first.
But are you able to see that now? Hello?
Yes.
You are able to see that now?
We can. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you very much. Sorry for the goof up. First of all, I would like to introduce the subject of ITS for the benefit of the people who have joined today's webinar. In my thinking, ITS basically starts from the basics, from the sensors. There are various types of sensors which are used for acquiring the data of various types. After that, through the means of communication technology, it moves to the computer. And computer in turn analyzes and gives the analytics of that. And finally, it goes for a control function or for a dissemination purpose for various types of activities. That in nutshell defines the word ITS. Okay, what exactly we mean by the word intelligent transport system and where it starts and where it finishes. Hello? Now, I just want to indicate that it plays very important role in various fields. In infrastructure, owners and operators, it tries to improve the quality and safety of the management of the transport network. For individual travelers, drivers, transport operators, and authorities, it makes them more informed, more intelligent journey decisions. For network operators and third-party service providers, it supplies advanced information services, increasing on multimodal basis to type all travelers. For road users, it helps them to drive safer and smarter vehicles. For utilities, it provides support to improve services in transport system operation, such as traffic management, commercial vehicle operation, transit management, and information to travelers. In general, it has potential to reduce travel time, reduce the frequency and severity of crashes, improve flow, reduce cost, and improve cost satisfaction. Various types of applications are displayed here. Some of them will be explained by our colleagues who will be presenting the paper, so I don't want to go into detail of that. ITS basically cut across all the disciplines of industry and its uses and utilities. In travel and traffic management, there are a host number of areas, users, which are affected by that. We will be covering a few of them today as a sort of an example. Similarly, in public transportation management, also it has got its own field in different areas. Electronic payment system. Then you go to the road network, public transport, urban flight, freights, highways, regional rail, airways, regional freight operations and handling. So you can see basically the all disciplines are covered. In our country, there is no single ministry who is responsible for handling this type of work. So individual ministries handle their own work in practically. Now, this is an example of your integrated fare management system, which is being implemented and which will be discussed briefly by one of the presenters. And similarly, for the smart parking, that's another important area. It has got a vast application for the common users. Now we are entering to a new era. So far we have been playing with the communication technology up to 4G. So you can see that basically this is the future. We are talking of now connected vehicles or autonomous vehicles. Those vehicles will be possible when the speed of your analyzing the signal time increases. We have started our journey in the telecommunication. Basically with the 1G technology, which helped us in transmitting the data to the various endpoints. And it had a speed of hardly 2 kb per second. Then we moved to the 2G technology. Thereby, we increased the processing speed by 384 kilobit per second. And the processing of each bit time was hardly 300 milliseconds. We have reached 4G. That means we are today having a speed of something like 1 gigabit per second. And the processing time has reduced to 60 milliseconds or 80 milliseconds. When we jump to 5G technology, we'll be entering the quantum jump. That means we will be going to 10 GB per second rate of transmission, and the processing time will be reduced to hardly 1 millisecond or even less. That will be the stage we will be talking about connected technology or the autonomous vehicles. From next year onwards, there will be a big challenge. Once the 5G technology comes, all these gates will be open to us. And so far, we are planning for that particular journey to start. So this gives an overview of your ITS and the areas it overall it covers. So I thank you for this brief presentation. And now I will move to the technical session, which will be first addressed by our guest speaker of the day. He is Mr. Sudhendu Jyoti Sinha. Mr. Sinha is an alumnus of St. Stephen College. His major was history. He has experience of over 27 years in operations and infrastructure planning, coordination and management while serving in Indian Railways. His performance has been recognized and he has won national award for e-governance in the year 2019 and 20 for excellence in providing citizen-centric delivery system, and also national award for outstanding service in the year 2006 from Ministry of Railways. He also served as Dean of the Indian Railways Institute of Transport Management, Lucknow. He was the General Manager, Web Applications at the Center for Railway Information System. Mr. Sinha received advanced management training in Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, Germany, and USA. Presently, Mr. Sinha is advisor to Niti Aayog, an apex think tank of Government of India. I had the opportunity of serving a panel on your ITS and submitted a report year last to Niti Aayog to be followed. I'm sure Mr. Sinha will have a look at that and give a direction for the future for the ITS in the country. So over to you, Mr. Sinha.
Thank you for the kind words, Mr. Banot. To all the distinguished officials of IRF who are so passionate about road safety and very naturally also, to all my co-speakers of the session, ladies and gentlemen, I extend my greetings to IRF first for thinking through and organizing this set of webinars and trying to bring into the spectrum, bring into the focus, the element of road safety and sensitizing one and all with regard to that. Now, the concept of ITS has been so well explained through the a set of, say, around 10 slides by Mr. Banot. And that really, that makes my role still lighter. So let me see, what do I see over that particular buildup of ITS? Now, what we see is that urbanization has brought in mobility as the center of the focus. There is a very, very high aspiration for the quality of mobility. People want standardized mobility, interoperable, multimodal, with, of course, space, well orchestrated, I should have used the word. It should be well orchestrated mobility. That is the demand of the time. Now, mobility does not mean that it should be telling upon the efficiency or safety factor, as it was so well explained and so well mentioned, that the main problem is that the way things are happening is causing lot of loss of life on the roads. And the worst of it is that a substantial proportion, almost 11% of it, happens in India. So it's time that we have a very, very serious look at it, try to see that how it can be reduced. I must appreciate the IRF officials who have taken it on themselves, a kind of personal commitment that they would be coming out with interventions that will have at least 50% reduction in this kind of mortality rate. Now, intelligent road transport system, intelligent transport system is definitely one of the most potent instrument for bringing down this mortality. I mean, there is absolutely no doubt about it. How to position it, how fast to position it, and what connects can be developed so that this mortality can be reduced. No, no, it's like approaching the entire ecosystem of the vehicle. It cannot be approached with a standalone kind of direction. So let's see what the earlier concept was. That if something is going wrong on the road, it is the mistake of the pedestrian, it is the mistake of the passers-by, it is mistake of let me put it this way, that whichever vehicle is of lower status, lower segment, that is responsible for it. Subsequently, a different paradigm came there, that no, mistake lies, the error lies on the other party. Whoever is the stronger, that is there. You see, what a strange kind of methodology we have been following, just to identify that whose mistake has been there and what corrective actions could be taken. Subsequently, it was the third stage was that something has gone wrong with the vehicle. Now, we have thought that, okay, the five E's that we have mentioned, that it is a complete thing, that in a way, it encompasses everything possible that has to be brought, that has to be handled carefully so that we have got less incidents of such mortality. Intelligent transport system, as I mentioned, and as we saw, it has got a huge, huge potential in bringing about the change. Vehicles ought to be connected to each other. They should be talking to each other. And these are all doable. There should be a system of alert, both for the one that is being hit and both for the one who is on the driving wheel. Now we have got systems like that. We have been able to identify for sure the black spots, and we are going in a concerted way in removing those black spots. We know that in different geographies, in difficult geographies, say hilly areas and areas with high rainfall, high landslides, how to handle these cases in that areas. We know that there are systems which always make the traffic alert that something on the say difficult bends, it makes the traffic alert that you should be careful about it. So in a way, how to take this intelligent transport system ahead? I have definitely gone through the recommendations, the report that has been submitted, and we are also trying to follow it up so that a concrete policy position can come out of it. At the same time, because as far as the sensitivity is concerned, that is definitely there. As far as the method to achieve that is there, that is also is an identified method. One doesn't have to go through it all over again. But the position is how to go about it, what should be the roadmap, what should be the clear timelines, deliverables, major deliverables. These things are what has to be worked out. And of course, a very clear-cut policy guideline is also needed. Let me assure you all from Niti Aayog side that there is a very, very clear understanding that we should be working, and of late, of course, it has further increased, that we should be working in this direction to ensure that among the so many stakeholders, among so many ministries involved in this particular spectrum, it could be MeitY, it could be DST, it could be MoRTH, it could be, and a number of them are there. MOEF could be there, number of them are there. So how to, we will be in a position to synchronize with that so that this intelligent transport system comes into action. Now it's equally important to see that the system that we want to develop, it is definitely, it should be the best of its class. At the same time, its affordability, its accessibility, that has to be also seen through, because we do not come out with systems where it becomes very, very difficult to, I mean, the cost proposition becomes very, very difficult. Of course, one could always argue that for human lives, no cost is a more cost. But yes, definitely it should be a system where from financial point of view also, it should be a doable proposition, or else we will have to go in for a kind of staggered or a kind of staged kind of intervention so that we are able to achieve it. At the end, I would only say that the kind of work that IRF is doing, and I will not be saying that it has not yielded results, it has. Even if in gross numbers the mortality rises there, but once you compare it as the vehicle density, then you realize that it has really been brought down. So lot of good efforts, lot of good work, lot of good suggestions, sensitization IRF has been doing, and we will be very happy from Niti Aayog side to touch base with you, to go in for a kind of continuous engagement with you, and see to it that a solid policy perspective is evolved, position taken forward, so that we can also claim to be one of the safest road transport system of the world, intelligent and at the same time the safest one. Thanks to all of you, and my greetings, my best wishes to the entire team. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sinha, for your wonderful words, and I'm glad that you had the chance to go through the report which was submitted by the expert team under my chairmanship. And one of the main recommendations of that committee was that at this moment, the subject of ITS is totally disintegrated in different ministries, and everyone is doing the thing in his own fashion. And there is no cohesion. There is no talking point to each other. So with the result, it was suggested therein that we should create an autonomous society on the top, which should be headed by Niti Aayog, and all the stakeholders should be a party to it. Today, in the field of ITS world over, there is no agency who can depute even an officer for attending a conference outside. You can see the dilemma, how the things are happening. So I think Niti Aayog should quickly take some steps on that, and we are there to help you whatever we can. And that report, which contains in detail the recommendation on different aspects. So I really glad that it will see the light of the day. Thank you very much, Mr. Sinha. Now I will come to the presentation of the papers by different speakers. First of all, Dr. Madhusudan Joshi will highlight and give you an overview of the ITS standards which are being made in BIS under my chairmanship. And Mr. Joshi happens to be the vice chairman of that said particular group, and he will give you an overview how the standards are being made and the whole field of ITS being led by that. Dr. Madhusudan Joshi did his PhD from IIT Delhi in the field of optoelectronics. He started his career with ARI in 2003 and now in ICAT Manesar. Dr. Joshi heads the electronics and electrical group business group in ICAT. He has more than 40 research papers in international journals and conferences and symposium. He is also the co-owner of 10 patents and 2 copyrights in different areas. He is the vice chairman of the sectional committee of ITS TED 28 of BIS, and also an active member of the BIS committees on e-mobility, automotive lighting and automotive electronics. Thereafter, Mr. Alok Sethi will take over, and Alok Sethi will present ITS applications in the field of your smart cities all over the country, which are the areas, and he will tell you the overall scope of that. Mr. Alok Sethi is the General Manager, Transportation Technology Solutions at DIMTS. He has 23 years experience in various ITS projects involving deployment of GPS, GIS, PIS, and ITS for paratransit, etc. Mr. Joshi is also associated in number of projects, including the one for vehicle tracking system of MoRTH, ITS for NER Raipur, and similarly other projects of MOUD. Mr. Sethi is also a member of many committees, including the BAS committee of TED 28, Smart City Task Force, BAS Smart Infrastructure Sectional Committee, LITD 28, to formulate relevant standards for the Indian industry. Thereafter, we'll move to Mr. Chaitanya Y. Bhatt, Speaker. Mr. Chaitanya Bhatt is the Chief Executive Officer of Surat Smart City Development Limited. He is also the Deputy Municipal Commissioner of Surat Municipal Corporation. He has been pivotal in the progress of Surat Smart City projects till date. Mr. Bhatt has a BE Civil Engineering degree from MS University in the year 1984 and also MBA in finance. He has a vast experience of 32 years with Surat Municipal Corporation, and since 2007, he is working as Deputy Municipal Commissioner. Since he is presently urgently engaged in some other important assignment, his paper will be read by Dr. Devshik Basak. He will be basically giving an example of the ITS application in the smart city of Surat. Thereafter, Mr. Professor P.K. Sarkar will give a presentation on ITS application for vulnerable road users, how it can benefit them, how ITS can play a role in that. Professor Sarkar is presently a visiting faculty engaged in teaching, research and consulting work in the area of transport planning at various institutes in the country. He has been actively involved as an expert on various consulting projects in the area of transport engineering, planning, economics, road safety, and ITS. Presently, he is an active member of various technical committees at the national and international level, like BIS, IRC, ISO. He is also the co-author of 4 books to his credit on transport planning, transport economics, and intelligent transport system and sustainable transport system. He was deputed to University of Mauritius for academic work as a part of UGC faculty exchange program in the year 2009, and also Commonwealth Academic Fellow at University of Newcastle, UK in the year 2013. He has received numerous awards for this outstanding contribution to the profession. Thereafter, Mr. Prakash Rosian of CDET, Joint Director, CDET, will be presenting a overview on the ITS application in the field of your transport management, intelligent transport management, how ITS can play a role in that. He will give examples of that. And they are not only presenting a paper, they are the basic R&D organization for ITS, probably in India, under the Ministry of Information and Technology. So they have done development of a large number of projects which he would like to share with you. Mr. Prakash Rosian has bachelor's degree in electronics and communication engineering from Manomaniam Sundaranar University, Tirunelveli, and ME degree in applied electronics from Madras University, Chennai. He is currently pursuing his PhD research at the National Institute of Technology, NIT, Tiruchirappalli. Mr. Rosian is working as joint director at CDET, and he has now almost 20 years experience, and is specialized in the embedded electronic systems development, and has worked new projects under his leadership on wireless traffic signal controller, red light violation detection system, emergency service vehicle priority system, pedestrian safety enhancement controllers. His research interests include embedded system intelligent transport system, INS based dead reckoning navigation and indoor positioning systems. So this will be the sequence of presenter and the background of the people. Now I will request the first speaker to give his presentation, that is Dr. Joshi, Madhusudan Joshi from ICAT. So over to you, Mr. Madhusudan. Mr. Madhusudan. Are you sharing your screen?
I think Dr. Madhusudan is not live. He's having some problems in connecting. So maybe we could connect, start with Mr. Alok Sethi.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. Mr. Alok Sethi. He will be presenting an overview on the ITS applications in the country as far as smart cities projects are concerned.
Thanks, Behnoor sir. I think Joshi ji had some issues connecting, so I will cover the basic ITS and current deployments in India. First of all, I'd like to thank IRF for organizing such a seminar, and wherein a very key aspect of road safety is getting touched. Usually ITS is talked about more about traffic lights and passenger transport facilities being enabled in various smart cities, but the very important point of road safety gets missed. So I would start. The initial presentation covers the key application areas of intelligent transportation systems in India. Currently, if you look at the key areas which get addressed is travel and traffic management. Basically, we have been seeing signals all across India for a long time. And if you look at last 5-7 years, we have been moving to intelligent signaling, wherein either it is controlled by the queue length or maybe various video sensors. And these are the areas wherein which has been done in almost the newer smart cities. The second visible areas where ITS has played a very strong role in the last 10 years is public transportation management, like Sinha sir was mentioning from Niti Aayog. Public transportation and managing a seamless transportation between buses, metros, and parent transit of autos has been a challenge in India with the kind of population we have. And that is where we saw the earlier implementations of ITS going in. And quite a lot of cities, quite a lot of bigger transportation entities like BEST in Mumbai, DTC and Cluster in Delhi, and BMTC, Bangalore, UPSRTC, UP, they've all experienced with ITS in public transport for a long time in last 10 years. Information management and how you manage customers and you provide them a better way of managing their transport has been a very key focus area. Essentially, to make travel hassle-free. So there were a lot of work being done by Ministry of Urban Development for managing, information or route planners for various cities, making a national urban transport helpline over the, all across the country. Electronic payments, as we know today, digital payments India has, grown by, leaps and bounds, and we are one of the largest transacting countries in the world. Electronic payments in transit make a very strong case because they enable a very seamless transfer, like when people get used to traveling in metro, they want the same facility to be available in autos, in buses, in taxis. So that's one area which has been implemented. And now with National Common Mobility Card being promoted by Government of India, this obviously is one area where we'll see a lot of traction. Commercial vehicle operations usually is an area which is, though it is driven by the demand available from the commercial industry, but not a lot of work has gone through from a, governmental perspective here. Emergency management is, ITS has always been contributing either in, vehicle dispatches, ambulance dispatches, but now with 112 helpline coming in, a broader ITS framework, which you could talk to multiple system, is being put up. And these areas are typically which have been addressed. And now, like Benod Saab mentioned in his presentation, there are multiple new areas, like vehicle to vehicle communication, vehicle to infrastructure. So all these are basic, stones. And then maybe when the technology of 5G comes in, we would have much more services to offer. Typical benefits is, if you look at public transport, it improves service quality, it improves the management and operation of those buses and the fleet per se, whether it is metro or whether it is buses and autos together. Improve productivity and resource allocation. Third point, which is very important in, city bus transport, is typically improved operational discipline, buses operating on a schedule, less accidents, better customer perception that, buses are coming on time and, we'll get a transport when required. Availability of information, accurate and extensive information availability of passengers about, buses arriving, whether seats are available on those buses. Similarly with metro, what is the fare from moving from one place to the other, alternate modes of transport like, autos, taxis. All this information, when an ITS system is put in and there is a government intervention or data sharing with government, enables a lot of data which could be used for planning and better management, with the frequency and, the ridership patterns of buses, we can plan how to, schedule buses, maybe improve or increase frequency on certain routes, reduce frequency on the other ones. Secondly, with more and more thought about mobility as a service, transport as a service, wherein people pay for what they use, timely and error-free data for administrative, financial and decision support system is something which is key to, an ITS deployment per se. We have been having, as I mentioned in the start, been having a lot of ITS interventions per city, but I've given you a small snapshot. So from the Smart City program, if you look at top 80% cities have a mobility component. So whether it is either public transit management or passenger information system or CCTV on buses or, parking management, all these are key, initiatives which are being done by each smart city. So having a standard and having a, collaborative environment where this data is available to multiple stakeholders is the way to go. And, with the building blocks of basic sensors or technologies implemented during the Smart City program, I think these things would, go to all the 100 smart cities and even more. So ITS implementations in India, there are many, basically being divided into two parts. ITS in India typically is implemented in two broader frameworks, whether it is transit oriented. So whether it is, GPS tracking, PIS boards on bus stations or electronic ticketing or, mobile based route manager or transport management for customers, is implemented all across. So Delhi, Bangalore, Ahmedabad, Bombay, even smaller cities, Indore, Bhopal, Nair Raipur. When you look at state-wise implementations, UPSRTC, KSRTC, they are all bigger, entities who have, tried ITS, but now they are moving to maybe the ITS 2.0, wherein more services get offered to commuters. Similarly, on the second part is the traffic part, wherein, signalings, enforcement, red light violations, overspeeding challans. These are themes which are common in all major cities. They started from a bigger vehicle population cities in Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad. But with smart cities coming in, I think you look at all smart cities, they are going ahead with ITS implementation with traffic. And they have big traffic control centers which could be used to control the lights. There are cities who are going with safe corridors, like Indore and other places, which could enable or speed up the emergency response system because a lane is being provided for emergency transport. Potential application areas are something which is currently a near term future for us, maybe the extension of whatever we have done today, and a lot of standards have been made, and government notifications like AS 140 have come up. So these potential application areas are something which we are looking at near term future. So if you look at something, there are a lot of cities who have gone for a ITS platform for public transport across multimodal transit platform across the city. So you will have metro, you will have buses, intelligent buses, intelligent fleet moving around, which is basically the connected bus and connected bus shelters. You enable light tracking feeds which are available to even commuters to see when the next bus is coming, whether seats are available. You have a passenger information system, a mobile app, or a website wherein you can plan your travel, you can see traffic patterns, you can see live video feeds of traffic junctions. Similarly, this data goes into smart congestion management, intelligent decision support systems, which is used on a citywide, on a administrative side decision making. And on the left side, if you have fare collection and optimal route optimization, using this data and enabling faster digital payments. Similar implementation in a bigger more generic smart city type implementation is wherein there is a smart city operating center with a city cloud, wherein multiple agencies share this data. So live traffic guidance is available, tracking is happening for public buses. The similar control center is available for police and ambulances to control their flow. It is important to mention government guidelines which are enabling like the smart city program. There are a lot of government initiatives which are promoting the use of such ITS technologies. So MOUD came up with a framework for National Urban Transport Helpline and a mobile number. This is something which is enabling traveler information system all across country, and in a way of a way and data formats to share data amongst various state and national level and city level vehicles. There is an AIS 140 guideline for vehicle tracking devices and emergency buttons in vehicles, which would enable states to create a lot of control centers. There is a MoRTH guideline on fast tags and maybe moving those fast tags to GPS based.
City, you will have to wind up.
So going forward is collaborative telematics application, which wherein all these sensors would share data. One of the various, because it's concentrated on road safety, what are we planning on ITS in road safety is basically, if you look at the way this triangle is functioned, for each fatality, we have close to around 600 near misses and around 3 lakh plus, other problems which could easily be monitored. So if you look at the top part, the emergency response system or AIS 140 caters to the accidents and near misses wherein there is a dispatch which happens. But the near misses and the 3 lakh other violations throw a very good data which could be used for planning and better like identifying black spots, identifying harsh braking areas, identifying areas where people are overspeeding and doing harsh accelerations. So these are ITS interventions wherein a base has already been set because of GPS being fitted in devices and could be used, because there are a lot of states like Himachal who are doing GPS based AIS based tracking and getting black spots and identification and notification of black spots through ITS technologies. So these features, harsh braking, harsh acceleration, these are available in AIS 140 device. This is where the data would come to control centers and would be shared all across India for managing such interventions. So that's the end of my presentation. Thanks again.
Thank you, Alok Shetty, for a wonderful presentation. And I hope Mr. Madhusudan Joshi is ready now. Madhusudan? Hello? Mr. Madhusudan? Are you there? Hello? Madhusudan?
Hello?
Madhusudan? I see him, but he's not speaking.
Yeah, he has just joined.
Joined, okay.
Just joined. So,
Madhusudan?
Dr. Joshi, you can share your screen and start, please.
Dr. Joshi, I'm not able to hear you. Hello?
Madhusudan,
Dr. Joshi, are you able to connect?
Okay. I understand Madhusudan is having some problem with the audio. So we can move to the next speaker. No problem.
Yes, that's right.
Next speaker.
Yeah.
You can go to the next speaker.
Yeah. So may I request from Smart City Surat, Dr. Basak should be there. Is Dr. Basak there?
Yes, sir. Can you see
okay.
me?
Okay, please go ahead.
Okay. Can you
can
see
share your screen? Yeah, please go ahead. We can see your screen. No problem.
Okay, sir. Can I start?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
So yes. Your time is 15 minutes, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. Let me introduce in very few seconds myself. I am Dr. Debashish Basak. I am a town planner of the Surat Municipal Corporation, and I am PhD in the quality of life, and had did my master's in urban planning from School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi, and I am a civil engineer from NIT Surat. Right now, I am going to present on behalf of Mr. C.Y. Bhatt, who is the Deputy Commissioner of the Surat Smart City. I'm going to present on IT applications in smart cities, that is Surat perspective. And it will be over within 30 seconds. Just a few words about this smart city mission and Surat smart city. One is the pan city, that is entire city or the whole city, and it is the proposal of 884.33 crore, and it is the ABD area, which is area based development. It is 8.77 square kilometer, having 7 town planning schemes and having rupees 2104.26 crore rupees projects. And the bifurcation of all the projects, as you can see in the bottom bar chart, having 12 projects in 348 crore, 9 projects of 538 crore. So these are the various projects of renewable energy, sewage, recyclable energy, water supply, then area development, Then in economic development, we have rupees 2.54 crore. Then housing and inclusiveness, we have rupees 8,589.64 crore. Can you switch to next slide? Yes. Now we have the challenges. What are the mobility challenges? That is rapid growth in population. You can see the population has increased from 2001, 28 lakh to 44.6 lakh, which is almost double in a decade. Then rapid growth in vehicles, that is 16.7 lakh vehicles added in last 10 years. Then high city mobility, 38 lakh passenger trips every day. High dependency on auto rickshaw, increase in congestion and inadequacies in the road network. Please next. Next slide. Now this is a unique concept. Why we call it as a Saral? That is, Saral means very easy. It is safe, accessible, reliable, advanced and low carbon. So through these, we want to strategize goals and policy direction. Next. Now this is an overview of the BRTS and the city bus services of the Surat city. Total network length of the BRTS is 110 km, while that of city bus, it is 404 km. Total routes are 12 for BRTS and it is 45 for the city bus. Total stations, it's 169 in BRTS and city bus, it is 774. Operational timing is from morning 6 to 9 p.m. There are 4 each depots in BRTS and city bus, 3 operators in Surat, and total buses is 157 in BRTS and 575 buses in city bus. It is one of the largest BRT network in India. Please, entire BRTS and city bus operations are monitored from a SMAC center, which I will show you in the next slide. Integrated transit management system and automatic fare collection system is also we have introduced. There are 300 electric buses that we will be procuring in the meantime for the Surat city, and public bicycle sharing system is also in the place. Next slide, please. ITMS, that is Intelligent Transit Management System. It is GPS-based automated vehicle location system. We have the real-time information and monitoring of the BRTs and city buses. Passenger Information System, that is PIS. Depot management, vehicle scheduling, management of critical parameters like bunching, headway, route violation, schedule violation, non-stoppage violation, and real-time information of citizens of the ETA. Next, please. Next. As you can see, this is a picture of automatic fare collection system in the BRTS bus station of Surat city, that you have to, show the QR code of the ticket and you can pass through the turnstile of the BRTS bus depot in Surat. It is integrated with Surat money card also. Money card for tap and go in the BRTS bus station. I hope you all can see the BRTS AFCS collection system. Next. This is the money card which one can use for the BRTS ticketing purpose. It is in the real-time environment. Next. This is the ITCS, that is Integrated Traffic Control System. Now this includes 267 junctions of the Surat. Red light violations, this includes red light violation detection system, then ANPR, speed violation detection system, traffic violation cameras, traffic surveillance cameras, emergency call box, VMS, that is variable message signboards at 20 locations, zebra and stop line marking, eChalan handheld device. Next. As I said in the previous slides, this is the command and control center, Command and Control Center, which is monitored from our Surat Municipal Corporation. Next. This is ITMAC. This is the, we have the MAC center at the Surat Municipal Corporation. We call it Integrated Transport Mobility Administration Center. It is a what we services we have monitored is the city bus and BRTS buses, emergency vehicles, solid waste management vehicles, and other vehicles. And we monitor 267 traffic junctions, then CCTV, then IT infrastructure, smart city street light, smart parking, environment sensors, water supply and drainage, that is SCADA, revenue collection, and other civic services. Please, next. Now, this is an important slide. I would like to draw your attention to this slide. India Urban Data Exchange. It is IUDX. That is the app that we have developed through the help of Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. That is the open source data sharing and exchange platform for IUDE. This is the one of the app. And the next app is the platform that allows sharing of data between multiple public and private stakeholders aimed at development of citizen and business-centric solutions. Surat, being a smart city with strong emphasis on data-driven governance, has been selected as one of the 5 smart cities for IUDX deployment. Now, key benefits is the operational efficiency by leveraging data, then strengthening ICCC, then driving city planning and prioritization, driving sustainability through data monetization, and innovative solutions for smart city issues. Next, please. Now, as you can see, one is the IUDX, that is bus, through which we can share the bus occupancy details for the commuters. That is, the commuter can see what is the occupancy level at the next bus. The existing CityLink app is designed to include this app. Then other apps which are in progress is the ARS TNT. That is the bus occupancy detail for the commuter. The app is in progress. Then CityLity, that is the multimodal app. This app will facilitate the citizen to plan their journey with different options, which are safer, greener, and cost effective using multimodal transit options like walk, buses, e-bike, private cab. Means you can see where is the cab, where is the walking option, where are the buses. Then Safety Pin. This is another important app, mobile app for the safer city, particularly for the female, to find out which are the safer areas that where they can commute. And this will be help to for a safer locations in the Surat. Next slide. Leveraging in transportation, that is analytics, integration, networking, information, and technology. That is, first is integration, networking, information, technology, and analytics. Analytics of ITMS and ARCS data to improve the efficiency of PT services. Transit performance indicator are ridership, that is the passenger per bus, revenue is the revenue per bus, then vehicle utilizations, earning per kilometer, vehicle utilization, cost per kilometer, accident rate, load factor, and occupancy ratio. Next, please. Now, this is the problem statement. That is the how we are managing the entire vehicle planning and scheduling for the maximum mobility and minimum resources. As you can see, there are 3 services, city bus and high mobility corridor, with integration.
Please wind up now.
Yes, sir. Now, there is an increase in ridership from 25,000 to 270,000, which has increased the fleet size. So, there is an increase in the total network, and therefore, there is an increase in the total staff. So, this is the entire scenario of the Surat BRTS system. Next, please. This is the process. That is the digitize the network simulation and implementation. Then VPS, that is the vehicle planning sharing, the synchronization plus converge other IT solutions, fine tuning of the existing deficiencies and stakeholder consultation. Next slide, please. This I will not go into the detail. This is the solution matrix. Next. This is the vehicle planning and scheduling, that is improving the level of service offered to passengers. Scheduling process with designing of a timetable of trips. That's transit scheduling process, which can vehicle planning and scheduling. Minimizing waiting time for improve the customer satisfaction, which increases the ridership and revenue. And maintaining schedule adherence in the traffic stretch. Next. These are the key outcomes, that is network digitization, route profile analysis, traffic assessment, demand and revenue assessment, system integration, cost and revenue model, resource allocation, and key performance indicators. Next. This is the replicability. As the time is short, I will not go into the detail. Only highlight the important points, that setting up the OD data and forecasting demand, all routes and stop screening for reroute engineering, crowd peak locations, depot allocation, city traffic analysis, TOD, that is transit oriented development, and connecting other IT solutions. Next slide, please. This is the sustainability. One is commuter related sustainability, another is route schedule, then division and depot related sustainability, and finance related sustainability. Next slide. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Basak. Excellent presentation. And I think this should be replicated all over the countries in the major cities. Excellent job done by the Surat.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So, Mr. Madhusudan, have you come back? Hello? Is it there? Mr. Madhusudan? Not yet. Okay. We move on to the
next one.
Yeah, no problem. So, Dr. Sarkar, you are ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Yeah. So, Ms. Dr. P.K. Sarkar, he will give you a presentation of ITS use for the vulnerable road users. Over to you, Dr. Sarkar.
Yeah, yeah.
Please share your screen.
Please unmute.
No,
please share your screen.
Yeah. Has it come? My screen is it visible?
No, it has not come so
far, not yet. Okay. Is it coming now?
No, not yet. Please unshare first and then share again.
You have to unshare it and then share it.
Okay.
First, keep the slide. Oh,
yes. Yeah, unshare. You have to unshare it.
And then,
can I request that from your side, if somebody operates my slide, is it possible? I have already handed over my slide. Yes.
Yeah, it has come.
Yeah.
It is there.
It has come from your side.
Okay. Thank you. I think there is some problem initially I could not recognize. Then you thank you very much.
No,
yeah, thank you, Chairman, for giving me an opportunity to talk on a very important subject that is called application of ITS technologies for safety for vulnerable road users. Now, to start with, I like to.
Yeah, we can see the next.
You can see the next? Okay.
Yeah.
Because as my subject is relates to the vulnerable road users, I just want to say state the vulnerable users are those relating to the pedestrian traffic, cyclists and motorcycle two wheelers. The question is, we see throughout the world there is a substantial number of VRU is involved in road accident leading to fatalities. As per 2015 statistics, we find around 49% are involved. And in India, in 2019, the numbers goes to the extent of 80,196, which is practically 57% of all fatalities in 2019 in terms of road accidents. What we would like to say that though we have been trying our level best to improve the safety and efficiency of motorized vehicles, but there is hardly any attention paid to the vulnerable road users in terms of ITS application. So keeping in view, I think there is some problem with my operation. I don't know why it is not happening.
You are not able to move the slide or what?
Yeah, that is the problem. I'm not in a position to move the.
Yes.
I have a lot of difficulties.
Okay.
And the next one is that to quickly give a glance that, as I said, around 50% accident related to VRUs. Out of that, 37% for motorized two wheelers, 17% for pedestrians and 3% for cyclists. And as I said that we need to see what are the possible ITS areas for application. I quickly just like to say I have just identified 14. Because of the paucity of time, I just like to say what are the main areas of which can be made use of. To start with, blind spot detection, intelligent pedestrian traffic signals, night vision and warning, intersection safety, red light, speed light violations, navigation systems for NMT, powered two-wheeler oncoming vehicle information systems, bicycle car communications, crossing adaptive lighting, vulnerable VRU beacon systems, and forward obstacle detection system and green wave for bicycles. Let me say one of the important things, as I said, for blind spot detection, we can, and wherever there is a blind spot is being created. I feel that generally when a left turn, when a truck traffic negotiating left turn, the driver is not in a position to see the nearest pedestrian's presence as well as bicycle's presence. As a result, lead to an accident. So the number of type of sensors used in this connection is radar, camera, and ultrasound system. I don't like to go into the detail about the functioning of the sensors, but only I can say among all these three sensors, I found based on our experience, radar seems to be very useful because it is very highly resilient in all kind of weather conditions. So therefore, the next is your pedestrian detection system. Pedestrian detection system is practically, you can see from the slide, a car is mounted with camera as well as radar.
Possible.
I think I'm some sound. Practically, the camera and the practical radar helps to detect the presence of pedestrians who are present nearby, and in case any kind of critical situation arises, the driver gets an alert like a beep beep sound, and in case the driver takes a decision to apply brake, fine. Otherwise, the system is such that it has a advanced electronic braking systems which automatically applied brake is applied, and then, a collision can be avoided. Next is that VRU beacon system. VRU beacon system is basically has been developed as a part of the project called Safe Way to School, which is basically RFID based VRU unit for children that consists of a standalone radio unit able to communicate with intelligent bus stop, which can warn driver with flashing lights about the vicinity of VRU. You can see a child has been now standing in front of the bus stop where the school bus are going to come. And so therefore, drivers, when you negotiate any kind of movement, he gets an alert that there is a presence of pedestrian, and he becomes cautious to take his take his move. The next one is intelligent pedestrian signals, because this is has been recently developed by Spain, and that in a traffic light turn amber signal whenever any pedestrian approaches and approaching the crossings, and in case a vehicle is driving at a speed of 30 km per hour, then immediately the red light was shown and warns the pedestrians of the danger. So this is the kind of automatic intelligent pedestrian signals. Also, you see the automated pedestrian detection systems. You can see on the picture below that this is a curb side. If anybody wants to cross the road, I can show you the better picture. Yes, you can see a person with a wheelchair, he wants to cross the road. As soon as he comes and wait into the area, there is a sensor. Sensor detects the presence of the persons with the wheelchair, and immediately, within no time, the green time is allocated to you to cross the roads, and therefore he feels safe. He did not press the push button for activation. And also, you see, there is another we call crossing adapting lighting in London, and mobile access, and we have seen that it has been recently operating in London. That is, whenever a vehicle and pedestrian wants to cross the road, a strip of red LED that light up the when pedestrian are crossing the streets. So automatically comes a red LED, which basically warns the vehicles that with a warning that you cannot cross, you cannot negotiate the road as pedestrians is crossing. Another important things I like to just highlight, one is called the mobile accessible pedestrian signal. Many people have not heard, but it has been already been researched in the University of Minnesota. In case a blind person, he wants to cross the roads, so he has a smartphone with him. So I can show you you can see from the picture, the blind person, he has a smartphone. Smartphone has number of sensors attached to it. And also he has a sunglass also fitted with a camera. And that means all the related information about he has also GPS fitted with the smartphone, GPS receiver. So this enables the roadside controller to activate, and because of which he gets the automatic call and it's audible. When he said that I want to cross the roads, then he sent all the information sent back to the this controller through the Bluetooth, and Bluetooth basically gives the detailed signal plan as well as road intersection geometrics to us to enable that whether he is in a position to cross the roads in appropriate time. So this is a detailed architecture along with the various sensors associated, it is basically wireless communication which is basically working with the traffic signal controller with Bluetooth.
You have 5 minutes more.
Okay, and this is an example of how the vehicles and pedestrians interact in the systems through the indirectly, directly. It enables the exchange of safety messages through the combination of cellular infrastructures and direct Wi-Fi communication. A central information processing server processes the safety messages that it receives from the vehicle and pedestrians and calculate the collision risk. So that's a wonderful arrangement of ensuring safety, and I'm trying to show number of sensors which are basically associated with vulnerable road users safety problem. One is the GPS. GPS basically talk about collision risk assessment. So I don't like to go into the detailed sensors associated with the VRU dedicated unit. So now I like to just mention, because the time is limited, there is something. I'm talking quickly about the project which has been undertaken in Europe Economic Europe Union about the ITS application for VRU. Yes, the project background is that it has been started in 2013 and 16. They felt that the VRU is not addressed properly. With a view to that, they have taken up a projects many parts of the Europe, and they have said that yes, the main objective is to assess the societal impacts of selected ITS and provide recommendations and policies. So and yes, the critical scenarios were evaluated through the ITS systems. One is the pedestrian crossings at the mid block. You can see pedestrian is crossing at the mid block. Then cyclist and power two wheelers. Then at junctions, vehicle pulling out. Here the vehicle is pulling out onto the path of VRU. Here also vehicle turning right to the VRU. Next one is that communication, because you have seen a junction here, there's a problem of the side distance, but they can still communicate because of the exchange information and warn for potential collision. You can also say bicycle to vehicle communication. Cyclist and car exchanges messages continuously and warn for potential collision. This is a cooperative system for VR of routes projects. A green wave allocated to the bicyclist. The system provides speed advice to the cyclist. This is related to intersection safety. It detects, roadside unit detects the VRU and warns the road users, and accordingly safety can be ensured. This is also another example. It has been in Helmond in Netherlands. This is also related to the intersection safety using the cooperative ITS. And quickly like to summarize, because there are, as I say, number of experiments has been carried out with the blind spot, cycle to vehicle, adaptive lighting, and intersection safety, two-wheelers, between two-wheelers and other vehicles, VRU beacon. Among all the experiments we have seen, we have been able to save at least 6% accidents with respect to for pedestrians with when we have a movement between power two wheeler, cyclists and other vehicles. We also VRU also minimizes accidents to the extent of 3%. So these are the details. There is no time, I am not going into the further detail. And this is a basically quantum benefits accrued because of ITS application. And you can see the pedestrian detection systems, whereas the pedestrians are immensely benefited. Benefit has been measured in terms of more than 10,000 million euros, and followed by the power two-wheelers benefit. And this is a basically quickly like to give you a glance that when you talk in terms of cost benefit analysis, we have seen the bike to vehicle as an intersection safety gives you the maximum benefit with respect to benefit cost ratio, which is more than 3, as well as when you see the net present value, which is also more than 500 million euros, particularly for these ITS applications.
Please wind up.
Yeah, just the technology use. Dedicated short train, GPS, wireframe, Wi-Fi, infrastructure sensors. Now, quickly, I'll just take for a minute or so. In BIS, we have been doing a formulation of standardizations with respect to school bus safety. I have taken up these projects. And which main purpose is that when a school kids move into the school buses, we have to ensure their safety, security. So systems can be developed where GPS, the buses can be fitted with ITS equipments like bus reader, which you call, has GSM, GPRS, GPS, RFID and camera. As soon as the vehicle, the school children do the boarding and alighting, immediately their movement is captured. And this simultaneously, when the movement is captured, this is the detailed communication is goes to the parents as well as the server of the institutes. And therefore, whether students are going safely or there is any problem, this, you can track their movements. And so therefore, what you need to have the system, and some countries has already been used, and we are trying to see what kind of standardization can be needed in order to make it effective for Indian conditions. Last conclusion, I like to say that VRU, as I said, is a neglected road users, involving more than 50% fatalities. And we have identified that among all the 14 ITS devices we have shown, VRU beacon systems, then bicycle to vehicle communication, blind spot monitoring would be of immense use in case we apply or implement this, what you call this kind of technology. And also study reveals that there's a substantial benefit accrued to the VRU. So now what is most required, standardization of communication technology interfaces is required, taking into account the VRU devices, restriction like power consumption, limited range, sensor accuracy. Finally, I'd like to conclude that we need to also look into the accuracy of the VRU's location, which should not be more than 5.5 meters. Finally, I say that yes, in case anybody interested to know about the research conducted at Minnesota University relating to blind person's safety at the junction, he can go to this link, and he will get the detailed information in as far as that how they have been able to conduct the research and how this has been implemented at various places in the United States. With that, I conclude. Thank you very much for hearing me patiently. Sorry that there is some trouble giving me in my
okay laptop. Dr. Sarkar, so we have overshot the time, so I'll request you to conclude. Thank you for your excellent presentation, and I think we have got a lot to do on this particular front, and we have to use the latest technology. I don't know whether in our chaotic atmosphere what sort of a technology will work, because even if people are violating the red or green signals left and right, so I think we have to work out a suitable solution. We'll debate on this in BIS and let's see what we can do. You'd given a number of ideas, so we'll work on that. Thank you. So may I now request Dr. Joshi if he's ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Please unmute.
Yeah, please go ahead. Please put your presentation. Please share your screen.
You are muted, please.
Madhusudan, you are muted.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Sorry for this technical glitch.
So your time is 15 minutes. Otherwise, Mr. Sikdar will kill me.
I will try to finish in 10 minutes.
No. I'm just joking.
Okay. So let me put it in presentation mode. Is it visible now?
Absolutely. Fine.
Okay. Yes, please.
So I will be actually trying to summarize basically what are the regulatory steps we have been taking in a committee under Bureau of Indian Standard, which is known as TD28. So smart and enabling ITS technology for road safety is the title of my presentation. These are the contents of the presentation. I will speak briefly about my institution to which I belong, then about TD28 of BIS, then list of activities we are doing in terms of standardization related to ITS in TD28, and then what I would like to conclude. So this is just a short introduction of the institution to which I belong, which is known as International Center for Automotive Technology. We were established in 2006, and we have about 600 people working very, very close to International Airport in Delhi, and we are spread over two locations in Manesar itself with an area of about 55 acres. So we are under Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises, and with an investment of about 1,350 crore rupees done by Ministry of Heavy Industries to set up this institution in northern part of the country. And Mr. Bhanot has been instrumental, is the founder father of ICAT. So when in the capacity of Director ARAI, so this institution has grown ever since he has left it. So we are actually authorized by Ministry of Transport to issue certification type approvals for all the automotive sub-assemblies, sub-components, full vehicles, etc. In addition to that, we do a lot of other activities related to research and development, validation, and we do all sort of activities which are related to skill development, competency development, as well as joint collaborations with the international institutions, which are listed here. So this is about TD28. TD28 is a sectional committee under Bureau of Indian Standard. TDC, which is called Transport Engineering Division, is being chaired by Director ICAT at present. Mr. Arar Singh is the head of TD, and TD28 is chaired by Mr. Bhanot, and I am also helping him as a vice chair to do certain activities related to ITS in TD28. This committee has a balanced composition from industry, which is OEMs as well as component manufacturers, then academia, the NGOs, testing agencies and government agencies, ministries, etc. These are the various panels which are actually be active at the present in TD28. For example, we have about 11 panels which are actively working at the moment, starting from panel on bus ITS, panel on traffic management, which is actually looked after by Mr. Prakash, who's going to make a presentation subsequent to my presentation from CDAC. Panel on rear park assistance system, traveler information system, which is looked up by my colleague, Mr. Lok Sethi, who has made a presentation already. Panel on ADAS, panel on vehicle tracking system, panel on RFID tags, then panel on RFID application tag application, which is looked after by Mr. Professor Sarkar, who just made a presentation. And then panel on e-ticketing, which is handled by Mr. Tarun Mohan. Panel on cyber security and functional safety, and panel on tire pressure monitoring system. So I will start one by one. The first panel is on bus ITS. Bus ITS is a very elaborate subject, and we understood about a couple of years back that it is very difficult to make a full-fledged standard for bus ITS because you know, there are a lot of topics which have to be covered as a part of bus ITS. So we thought of creating an umbrella standard, which is actually a reference standard mainly, and which will keep on we will keep on adding the different you know, topics on it, as in the form of the, you know, child standards. And some of these standards have already been completed, like IS 16833, which is related to automotive tracking devices, related to LED destination board, and other topics have also been done. We should be covering in the subsequent slide. And some of the topics we have to decide whether we should be considering in ITS, but this is how we assume it to be, that there will be umbrella standard, and which will be a kind of a reference standard, and then will lot of child standards will be cross-referred in that. So the first one is IS 16490, which has been a standard which was conceptualized by us as the first standard in TD 28, which is mainly related to LED based destination board systems for buses, which mainly has a controller with a driver control console, then cameras, and all four different boards of front, rear, and side as a part of the system. So this standard, we tried to put a lot of performance parameters, then a lot of environmental testing related requirements, electromagnetic compatibility related requirements, some durability tests, some mechanical validation, some durability electrical tests, etc. So this standard was first of its kind. There was no international precedence available for as far as this standard is concerned. And as we are also attending ISO-TC 204 committee meetings internationally, so the TC 204 has recognized the work done by TD 28 in this regard, and they have adopted this standard in ISO. They are working on it, and we have been given responsibility to prepare a draft and present in whenever next meeting happens. Because of COVID, the activities have been delayed, but this has been adopted as an international standard also. So this is about LED destination boards. The second is IS 16833, which has been a quite exhaustive standard. It has four parts. This is mainly related to automotive tracking devices, and also considering some of the integrated systems in different combinations. The first is ATD with a emergency system, which is the simplest one. The second one is the tracking devices with the integrated emergency system and a fare meter. The part C consists of CCTV with integrated emergency system, and the last one is the is the most exhaustive one, which covers CCTV with a built-in tracking and an emergency response system. So these are the four parts, and these four parts are used by various stakeholders as per the requirements whenever they arise. And the important stakeholders in this regard are the agencies like NIC, who are actually the kind of national database, or some other agencies which are coming up. Then a program management unit, test agencies like us and ARAI, then backend service providers, OEMs and VTS manufacturers, and of course for standardization BIS. So this is about annexure A, which is the most basic one, which has a tracking device which is fitted into the vehicles. Then the navigation or the location based systems are run through GPS or INSS or NAVIC, which is the Indian counterpart of GPS. And the communication to the cloud or the server is done through GPRS or GSM. So here there is usually a dedicated server for emergency response. This is very important from the passenger safety point of view. This exercise has been the motivation has been the Nirbhaya scheme, which is launched by MORT, where we have taken this initiative to form the standard for this topic. And then also a server which is actually housing the data, which is generating out of day-to-day usage and movement of the vehicles. So here is the architecture which is normally the same, and this kind of architecture is commonly known for all tracking applications. Then the second part is about this tracking device, which has an integrated digital fare meter, where we can do a lot of activities like fare collection, complaint management can be done, panic management can be done. You know, it can be acting as a vendor interface. We can do trip-based tracking. So this kind of architecture is also very common nowadays, and it has been some of the initiatives have already started in states like Goa, etc., where this has been implemented. The next is about the CCTV system with integrated emergency system, a tracking device and emergency response system, where we have a complete video monitoring unit, including cameras, the controllers, the recorders, and communicating with the server. The display is available to the driver, or it can be available to any of the device like mobile phone, etc., based on the requirement. So through GSM connectivity, these videos are transferred. The live videos can be transferred, and this has really helped to enhance the safety to a greater extent. So this is also as a part of 16833 Annexure C, this has been covered, and the similar kind of test has been also, put in the standard to validate these devices for performance, durability, etc. Then we have this RFID standard on RFID tags, which has also been finalized under TD28 as IS 16722. So these requirements have been aligned with the requirements from put forth by MoRTH and National Highway Authority of India. Now this standard consists of two parts. One is related to the definition and validation of the RFID tags, and also the second part consists of the validation methodology for readers or the transceivers. So all different kinds of tests which are applicable to validate the performance of these tags has been highlighted in the standard. The next one is also a standard which has been recently finalized, and this standard is actually about tire pressure monitoring system. This covers all different types of TPMS, whether it is direct or indirect. What we have done, so there is a standard is already existing, which is called AIS 154, but it talks about only vehicle level validations. But whereas this IS standard is concerned, we have tried to cover also the subsystem level validation to authenticate the robustness of the TPMS, because TPMS is a very, very critical device in terms of road safety. So we envisaged that in this TD28 committee that it is very, very important to also validate the subsystem level requirements at TPMS. So that is how this standard has been finalized and already is in the process of publication now. The next one, which is also finalized, is again related to road safety, which is reverse parking alert system. This standard again has been initially done as AS 145, but also only consisting of vehicle level requirements. So we have finalized this. We have improved the standard in IS as IS 17270, where we have tried to incorporate the subsystem level validations of related to RPAS. So this standard is also published and now available, is available for notification. The next standard, which is already in process of development, is about the electronic ticketing system, which we also known as automatic fare collection system. With the basic architecture is that there is a management end which consists of a payment gateway and transit operators. Then there is a servers and a cloud or server system sitting here to manage all the data and manage all the financial transactions happening. There is a unit sitting inside the vehicle, bus, typically a bus, which actually interfaces with this backend, and we have interfaces like near field communication readers or quick response code scanners, or other methodologies in order to for a use as a user interface to do these transactions of automatic fare collection. And there is a ITS signal control unit sitting in the bus, a display unit with a driver, and you know these units of you know, which are actually the payment interface, are available at both inlet and the outlet of the bus. We have so these units will be sitting inside, and then we have these terminals like point of sales terminals where we can you know, issue some cards like NCMC card, which is a card which can be used India wide, which is already in discussion with Ministry of Information Technology. They are working on it, and hopefully this will be soon be finalized. And we believe that by the time we try to finalize our standard, all other things will also be finalized. Just to mention that we are not trying to cover anything related to financial transactions in this standard. We are only talking about architecture and validation of these AFCS systems in the, as far as this standard is concerned in IES. So the next important topic, which is also under discussion, and we would try to finalize this by December 21, is a standard related to functional safety and also cyber security. So this is kind of very standard process which is available, and we have to now try to adopt it in terms of automotive, where we start from product concept, try to you know, define the scope, do the risk assessment, and list all the safety and the security requirement, do the allocation, identify the electrical electronic system or the programmable electronic system where this can be deployed. Then you know, do overall installation commissioning, do the validation through softwares, and you know, ultimately you know, suggest if there are some maintenance or repairs or some malfunctions which may be detected, and then finally decommission the system. So this functional safety has various levels, as you can see here, level A to D. So this is how we would like to classify through the standard while doing functional safety assessment of any system. So this provides defense against random and systematic failure. So it also helps OEMs and you know, set makers to you know, handle the warranty claims which may be arising out of the failures of the system. In addition, cybersecurity also is an important area where we do the similar steps, set up security goals rather instead of safety goals, finalize the security requirements, and then assess the system and assign the level 1 to 4 of securities. This actually would help in to you defend against the negligent and willful actions to protect devices and facilities. So these two are highly required standards as far as ITS is concerned. The more we are getting into connectivity, the more is the requirement of functional safety and cybersecurity. So we anticipated this need, and we will try to you know, work towards finalization of the standard by December 21. The next one, which is on the table, is a very important standard, which is ADAS. ADAS, as you know, is a very, very broad terminology. We are have tried to list out the various topics which may form a part of ADAS. It's very tricky to start where to start with, but we have been discussing this for quite some time, and we believe that by July 22, we should be able to come up with the first draft of the standard. These are the various levels of the standard ADAS defined in SAE J3016. The idea is that we will try to finalize the standard which exhaustively covers the complete requirement up to level 5. And we also understand that implementation of level 5 will be very, very tough and difficult in the beginning as far as India is concerned. So we will also try to give our recommendations that what kind of level can be you know, proposed in the beginning when this we are really starting with this ADAS, and we think that level 3 should be appropriate, where we provide a conditional automation. So high automation and full automation, we feel that it is not the right time. It will not be right time to start in India, depending upon the traffic and road conditions. Then now, this standard is also looked after by my colleague Mr. Alok Sethi, and he's helping us, and we will try to bring up this standard by December 21, where we are trying to you know, finalize the requirements of traveler information system. idea is to develop a helpline, which is 24/7 helpline, which is National Urban Transport Helpline, which will house all the data related to transit service provider, traffic control, and also related to parking, toll, weather, etc. And the same can be communicated in real time through various means to the end user, and which will ease out the, you know, some of the hassles for the your travelers. So this will try to finalize by December 21, based on the architecture which is proposed here. And the last one, which CDAC is going to present today, is the standard on traffic management system. So we believe that we should be able to finalize this by December 21. So CDAC has done a lot of work on this area. So whether it is red light violation detection, or you know, automatic number plate recognition, etc. So they are trying to work on this, and I think my colleague from CDAC will you know, do a detailed presentation on this. So this is what I would like to say as far as traffic management is concerned. So we will try to come up with the standard within this timeline, which is we have agreed with the chairman at TD28. So to conclude that we have been progressing reasonably well as far as TD28 is concerned. We had been able to finalize four standards so far, and work is on seven different topics, and also one topic which is the last one, which is RFID application for school buses. We have started discussing about this topic very recently, but we will definitely set up a time target to finish this standard also, where Professor Sarkar is helping us to bring out this standard. And we are also open to discuss any new topic which can be useful to, you know, enhance the road safety and mitigate the risk for the travelers, passengers, or the vehicles. So any suggestions in this regard will be highly welcome. So you can you know, give us all your suggestions, and we will try to see how what best we can do to make a standard or to decide a topic of standardization based on the requirement. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Madhusudan, for an excellent overview of the activities being carried out by TED28. I think it will set a benchmark for the country to follow. Now we have got the last speaker. I appreciate the patience which Dr. Prakash has shown. And over to you, Dr. Prakash, for presentation on intelligent transport systems.
Is it visible, sir?
Yes.
I'm audible also.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm Prakash, working in Center for Development of Advanced Computing, CDAC, Thiruvananthapuram. First of all, I would like to express my sincere thanks to the organizers and Mr. Balraj Bennett, who has given an opportunity to talk in this forum. Actually, the topic given to me is indigenously developed ITMS components and its use cases. So I am planning to give some insight into these various products and how it plays a role in road safety. The Center for Development of Advanced Computing, CDAC, is basically a premier R&D organization under Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. We focus mainly on the area of electronics as well as information technology researches. And mostly we will come out with some products. All these products will be technology transferred to the medium scale industries, and further productions and commercialization will be taken care by them. This is our approach. And we have 12 centers across the country with more than 3,000 employees. And the head office is at Pune. I am working at Thiruvananthapuram. We have a different expertise in the area of high performance computing, artificial intelligence and multi-language computing, then microprocessing, professional electronics. So we have a RISC-V indigenously developed processor even, intelligent transportation system, health informatics, cyber security and cyber forensics. We have a well set up lab. then software technologies, 5Gs, IoTs, edge computing, education and training even. So all these are our expertise area, and I am working in the area called intelligent transportation system. We have a small group in our organization, it's intelligent transportation system. So I'm going to cover this ITMS areas, ITMS components. CDAC for the last 10 to 15 years, we are into the product development, and we have come out with some time-tested products. So solar power operated, vehicle activated, traffic signal controller. We have two versions, Vitrac and Qt. Then adaptive traffic control systems, which handles mixed traffic conditions as per Indian road. Then emergency service vehicle priority system, then parking management system, red light enforcement system, and we have a new product, differently abled pedestrian access controller, PESCO. Along with this completed products, we have some ongoing projects in association with IITs. All these projects were funded by MIT, promoting road safety through deployment of driver assistance and warning system. This we do in collaboration with IIT Madras. And development of bus priority system at signalized intersection. This is basically giving priority to the buses. Then departure time planners in collaboration with IIT Madras. Data-driven model and decision support tool for improved transit reliability. Then development of smart vision sensors like development of thermal as well as CMOS cameras. So far, no indigenous development has been initiated in our country. So we do first time in India thermal camera development. Then development of common service layer. This is basically a one MTM standard we are developing. This is in order to achieve the interoperability between communication equipments. And we have a product development of desktop based simulators, mainly used for this RTO offices. The first product is wireless traffic signal controller. Why we have gone to this Vitrac? So you all of us knows the normally available traffic signal controller, which has a small hardware unit, which is connected to the LED aspect or the lamps on the pole through wires. So this requires a lot of wiring, a lot of ducting. It's a hectic job in the road, on the road to do this, and this requires a lot of manpower, implementation cost, as well as infrastructure cost, and even permission hassles also. So in order to avoid that, in the year 2009, we have started a product and completed in 2012. It's a wireless traffic signal controller, which controls the lamps through wireless medium. That is, every dedicated pole will have a small electronic component. The first one we call it as masters, and other units we call slave. The communication between master to slave happens through 2.4 gigahertz radio communication. So it switches the lamp pattern, so the slaves receives it and switches the lamp as per the pattern. So every the total plan and the traffic signaling plan will resides in the master controller. So this traffic signal controller, which supports ATCS, then it has a GPS enabled facility. It is vehicle activated. It supports adaptive traffic signaling. It's solar powered, pole mountable. These are the salient features of our traffic signal controller. So in some cases, we require this wired controller also. Sometimes in some smart cities, already the wirings may be there. In such cases, we have a dedicated solution with a wired solution. The features remain same with the similar to that of the traffic signal controller. Then we have an adaptive traffic control system, ATCS software. This ATCS gives a progressive green signal for the travelers from one junction to the other junction in a corridor. So once he starts from point A to point B, the traveler should get continuous progressive green time. This is achieved by our product CosiCost. That is the algorithm part. This is a patented concept which works well in Indian road conditions. That is composite signal control strategies. So most of the imported components failed in our country, but this CosiCost we have implemented in multiple across our country, and it got a very good success. Along with this adaptive traffic control system, we have a product called TramNV. That is a traffic monitoring and management software, which basically monitors the traffic signaling functionality and displays over a UI, user interface, and the traffic signal controller can be controlled from the remote server also. That is the feature of this TRAM software. So we have two products. One is the TRAM software for controlling the traffic signal controller, and another one is adaptive traffic control signal, which gives progressive green signal for the traffic vehicles. This ATCS has been implemented. So we have implemented in four places on turnkey basis, on commercial, there is a nomination basis, or to various places like Pune, Jaipur, then Indore, Hubli. And this has been implemented by our technology partners in Bhubaneswar, Patna, Gwalior, Srinagar, and multiple places across our country. So basically, this wireless traffic signal controller has been given, technology transfer has been given to 8 TOT partners, and they are excelling in, and they are implementing all over the country. Next, I will be presenting this emergency service vehicle priority system. So why we request this emergency service vehicle priority system is a very relevant topic to our road safety. According to the report of Times of India, every 1.46 lakhs of people were killed in road accidents. This is the report in 2016, of which 13% of the deaths are due to delayed ambulance. And 2019 report from MORT says that it's around 1.5 lakhs. So on an average, heart attack patient in India takes 400 minutes to reach the hospital, which is in the global scenario, which is 13 times more than the ideal window of 30 minutes. So all of us know this golden hours and platinum 10 minutes concept. As soon as possible, this patient should be taken to the hospital. So we have prioritized that and come out with a product called emergency vehicle priority system, which gives green signal to the emergency vehicles when it approaches the road, and it stops all other vehicles in the other roads. So this solution, people have come out with a lot of solutions like infrared solutions, radio frequency solutions. We have made a sophisticated, innovative solution. This is a GNSS and radio-based localized solution. So normally this wireless communication, we may face a lot of delays in network or in terms of the switching frequencies and all. But this radio-based localized solution avoids all problems, and we use geofencing for resolving the vehicle position. And it is very easy for the installation, and no network failures are there. This is about the emergency service vehicle priority system, which will have mainly two units. One is the vehicle mount unit, which will be kept on the dashboard of the emergency vehicle, which requires preemption request. And this controller unit will be kept on the traffic signal controller itself. So this vehicle mount unit keep on sending its positional data from the GPS or GNSS through wireless link. So the local controller unit receives this and identifies that what is the location of this vehicle, whether it has come nearby within the geofence area, as well as it identifies the heading angle also to identify the direction, because we are not supposed to give false triggering. So it identifies that and switches the green signal of the traffic signal controller. And the novelty of our system is it can be connected to any existing traffic signal controller. The traffic signal controller need not to be changed. That is the main innovation what we have done in our product, along with this GPS and decentralized solution. And this product has been implemented in 2017. It was implemented, and it is operational from that onwards. Actually, one junction in Thiruvananthapuram, Kumarapuram Junction, we implemented this product. And one of the hospital, KIMS Hospital, is enabled with one emergency vehicle. And this is well appreciated by Kerala Police also. They have recommended us to implement all over the country in association with Health Department and IMA. The certificate regarding that is also presented here. And in order to understand the impact analysis, we have given to an external agency, NATPAC, as per the study. So this has been done by using some sophisticated hardware as well as manual enumerators, And we have found that the average reduction in travel time, we got up to 48%. The next product is intelligent parking management system. Am I audible? Okay. So IPLMS components, this entry gate subsystem, parking lot subsystem, exit gate, then parking navigation, driver guidance. So we have a product to support all such categories. We have an indigenous hardware for entry gate, exit gate, parking management, and even parking sensors, even parking lamp also. This parking sensor we implemented using ultrasonic sensor. It's a system architecture of IPLMS, whatever we have implemented. The entry gate will be connected with the various vehicle detection sensors, boom barriers, license plate recognition, camera, then barcode printers. Similarly, in the exit gate also, all these sophisticated equipments are available. This is a system architecture of a parking lot management system. The sensor used in this parking lot is basically ultrasonic sensor. And this product has been implemented in Hari Babu Narayanpet at Pune in 192 cars. This is the implementation site. Then red light violation system, detection system, as Madhusudanan sir rightly said, we have a product, end-to-end full product developed by CDAC. It is identifies red light violation at signalized road traffic junctions. This is implemented by using multiple cameras, like for recording the evidence, we have an evidence camera, video camera. Then a license, for in order to take the license plate, we have a still image camera. So by keeping in a perfect position, which will take the evidence along with the number plates and generates digital evidences of the violation. So this it retrieves license plate details from the image of the red signal. Then it retrieves the registered owner detail from the RTO database, and it generates challans. This will be present in front of the court. This is about red light violation detection system. It has a dedicated hardware, and this hardware supports, normally people will be implementing this red light violation detection system one hardware per approach. But our hardware we have developed a hardware in an innovative way, which will cover four arm of the junction with a single hardware unit itself. This will be the typical evidence shown, how it will be showing the evidences. It has a three snapshot progressive moments, so that this can be presented over to the court if anyone is challenging. Along with that, it has since it is backfired from the back, we are taking the snapshot. We could able to see the red signal when the vehicle is moving. Along with that, we are recording the video also. Then the next product is pedestrian friendly signal, PESCO. So normally we have a product called a Pelican controller. So all of us know that.
Please hurry up.
Yeah, yes, sir. So this Pelican controller, it's now it has a normal push button. As Sarkar sir said, PK Sarkar sir said, he has shown some slides which has been implemented in London, like some physically challenged people, how they will be walking through this this one. Actually, by considering that, we have developed a product called a pedestrian friendly signal controller. Basically, we understand that what type of pedestrian are coming through RFID tag. So every pedestrian visually challenged or physically challenged or elder people will be provided with the RFID tag. They will have a unique ID for them. Once they come and show this RFID card nearby this hardware, it understands the disability category. According to that, it gives the extended green time. For the normal Pelican controllers, the green time will be always fixed. But in this case, as per the whatever the configured value, we could able to give a configured this extended green time. And moreover, we support this blind people's also visually challenged people also through smart cane interface, because nowadays they are coming with smart cane, which works based on the concept of ultrasonic sensor. Once they come nearby this box, once they show in front of the box, automatically they will be detected as per the ultrasound. Once they come with ultrasonic sensor, we will be giving a fixed time, extended green time for that. This is about the Pelican controller, pedestrian safety enhanced controller. So it's a live web interface of PESCO through which we could able to configure the various timing values, and it shows the demonstration of that. And this product has been implemented in two places. One is Visually Challenging School at Thiruvananthapuram. Another one is mid-block in front of Government Girls Higher Secondary School, Cotton Hill, Thiruvananthapuram. These are the implementation of PESCO. So these are the various products whatever we have developed and implemented, so which provides safety, road safety, I hope. And I conclude by saying that we should find one day with accident-free and crash-free world. Hope this is possible by our technology innovations. So thank you.
Thank you, Prakash, for excellent presentation for the so-called Atmanirbhar Bharat. So these products can be taken up for manufacture quickly and implemented throughout the country. So now we will get into the question and answer session. So I like to seek the help of organizers if there are any questions which they have got in the chat box.
Yeah, Mr. Bhanat, I mean, actually we are already late, so
okay.
I will only request you to ask just one question, which I'm taking okay. from this question answer box.
Okay.
What is the work of loop detector? Someone anonymously asked. I mean, I don't have the name.
What is the
work of loop detector? I mean, he of loop course, detector? It is not connected to any of the presentation, but he has just asked a open-ended question. What is loop? The work or yes. purpose of a loop detector?
I can answer this question, sir. This loop detector is basically this put on the road surface, which will be mainly used for vehicle detection. So in order to give the extended green time in the, that is vehicle activated traffic signal controller, this is the main component, loop detector. So but nowadays, because it get damaged, we replace it by using a video camera based solutions.
Thank you.
These are used for controlling the traffic signaling, basically,
exactly.
depending upon the traffic density in a particular route.
Yes.
So there are different type of sensors. They are embedded under the earth also in the road structure. So now they are finding it that video technology is far better. Anyway, this is the involved subject. Any other question?
There is no other question at the moment. I mean, there are few, okay. but at the okay. moment we are left with just 1 or 2 minutes. So kindly okay. Give your concluding remarks and then wind up, please.
Okay. So I think we had excellent presentation today, and the subject being too wide to summarize that will be very difficult. So because each one is in its own direction. But as I mentioned, that the use of ITS is tremendous. We are just opened up a small gate in our country. And once the 5G technology comes, I think we have to leapfrog in this particular area. At this moment, we have merely identified the areas, nothing more than that. And we are gradually trying to standardize the manufacture by making different standards in limited areas as they come along. Otherwise, as I mentioned to you, that this subject is being handled by various ministries. There is no common ministry who is looking after this subject. We have requested the planning, your Niti Aayog also in our committee recommendation, you create an umbrella organization so that some direction is given to this particular area. So each one is working, intelligent transport system are working in their area. Smart people, smart city project is working in a different area. And in the smart city project also, I understand there are problems of linkage from one system to another system. One city cannot talk to another city. So there are problems of common layer. So there are a number of issues, not one. Similarly, in the standardization also, we notice problems are there. Different states take up the different projects. In the absence of any standards, normally the whole project is being led by the consultants. Whichever country they belong to, they pick up those standards and implement the project. I have noticed the NHI also has brought out a large number of guidelines. And when I went through the whole guidelines, I noticed that all standards are EC standards. There is no equivalent Indian standard. So I think we have to first of all, implement the whole thing through a process of standardization. So I think standardization will be the key for a common factor to give a thrust to this area. Otherwise, we'll be fighting in different platforms for following a different route. So I'm, in my opinion, standardization is the key thing if we want to give a promotion to the ITS in this country. And also creation of an umbrella organization which should have stakeholders from all the departments. And it should be under the head of your Niti Aayog. So this is one of our main recommendations in our main committee, which was headed by in our Niti Aayog also, and which was IRF was a party to that. So I was the chairman of that committee, and we recommended there also. I hope that report finds some sort of a solution, and it is given a due attention. So I think with these remarks, I will only compliment the IRF for organizing this particular webinar. So I think it must have educated all the participants what all is going on in our country in the field of ITS and what more can be done. Thank you, gentlemen, for your participation. Over to you, Mr. Sigdar.
Well, thank you, Mr. Vanat. Excellently kind of moderated the entire the technical part of this webinar. And as it is shown in the slide, the next webinar, the eighth one, is on 27th of August on vehicle technologies for road safety. As it has been said at the beginning, that the entire series is focused on road safety, aiming to develop an action plan for road safety. And the next one is on vehicle technologies for road safety. Thank you very much to all attendees, and special thanks to the moderator and all the speakers. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we can put it off now, please.
Thank you.